Bethel Chapel and Hopewell AME Church and our virtual family and friends. Welcome to our online services. We are so glad you chose to worship with us. May today's worship encourage, inspire, and uplift you. Let's get ready to worship.
Well, good morning, my brothers and sisters. Welcome to worship at Bethel Chapel and Hopewell AME Church. We are so glad to be able to have you come into our worship experience, into our hearts, into our homes. God's presence is where we are, and we're thankful, amen, this morning to give God all the praise. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Our call to worship this morning said, the Lord has been our refuge and our keeper. It is God who has kept us from falling and saved our lives. Let us thanks and praise God. Let his praise resound throughout this place of worship. Let our love and gratitude be shown in all that we say and all that we do. Open your hearts, open your spirits to God this day. Lord, be with us and place your hand of healing on our lives and let us walk by faith and not by sight. This we declare in Jesus' name. Amen. Our hymn this morning, down at the cross where my Savior died, down there from cleansing from sin I cried. There to my heart was the blood applied. I'm singing glory, yes, glory to his name. Let us sing this great hymn of the church, hymn number 243, down at the cross.
Healing. Glory to his name. Peter, glory to his name. from your burden of sin. There's power in the blood. There is power in the blood. Would you over evil, a victory here to win? There's wondrous working power.
Praise the Lord, my brothers and sisters. This is a wonderful opportunity we have to share together this morning from the Word of God. And I have with me some very special guests who are going to join me in this discussion. We're going to have a very important discussion about faith works. And I have with me Dr. Keith Jr. and also Dr. Stephanie Morgan Fry. Good to see each of you, and God bless you. Thank you for joining Pastor Trent Ogilvie, Pastor Bethel Chapel and Hopewell AME Churches. And we are thankful this morning to be able to share the Word of God on this Sunday, because this topic is really important. It talks about faith works, how faith works, and how you can work through your faith in God. It is important. We've all said, you know, heard it said that the just shall live by faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. And so we're going to really talk about that faith in action and going to James chapter 2. I want to just read the scripture, and then I'm going to introduce our guest so that you can hear from them this morning. In James chapter 2, beginning at verse 14, it says, "What good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save him? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, 'Go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed,' but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. But someone will say, 'You have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by what I do.' You believe that there is one God, good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. You foolish man, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless? Was not our ancestor Abraham considered righteous for what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see that his faith and his actions were working together, and his faith was made complete by what he did. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, and he was called God's friend. You see that a person is justified by what he does and not by faith alone. In the same way, was not even Rahab the prostitute considered righteous for what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and sent them off in a different direction? As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. So faith works. And we'll start, Dr. Stephanie Morgan Fry, tell me about kind of how you've been, what you're doing, involved in now, and then we'll hear from Dr. Junior.
Well, I've been doing well. Good. Thank you for asking. And I'm still, you know, of course, doing the weight loss program and working as corporate compliance officer, and which is for a home health agency. But it's like I'm the compliance officer and administrator and everything else too. So I'm pretty much having to run the whole gamut. So
all in.
Yes. Making a lot of decisions about, you know, patients' admissions. We're doing something special in this time with, you know, a lot of the coronavirus patients that are positive and having to make decisions about taking care of them and how we take care of them and things like that, in addition to all the other home health patients. So it's a very busy time, but it's very rewarding to know that you can, you know, help somebody.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's what we talk about, that faith and action, being able to use your skills and gifts that God has given you to be able to bless somebody else. Mm-hmm. Dr. Junior, tell me about how things are going with you now.
Things are going well. I work at Matthew Walker Comprehensive Health Center, both in Nashville and in Clarksville. And it's just being on the front line, seeing patients every day, and just trying to help them with their healthcare needs.
Yes. And I know it's critical being on the front lines and seeing all that you see and the kind of the stress, the anxiety, a lot of uncertainty with health right now. People, it's one thing to see the person in the mirror that you got to kind of keep in check and make sure you do the right thing with medicine and so forth. But now we have this unseen, you know, virus and coronavirus and other things. So it just causes you to be a little anxious and a little afraid of the unknown. But both of you, in your perspectives, have very important roles in what you do. And can you tell me, how do you personally, how does your faith in God help you do what you do every day? And we'll start with you, Dr. Fry.
Well, my faith in God is, of course, is the strong point that I lean on every single day. It's what I pull to whenever, you know, I feel like I'm facing a crisis or whatever, but I know that God is always with me. But as I make decisions and, you know, realize what my calling is and what I'm supposed to do, I have a tendency to put myself in their predicament and, you know, how would I want somebody to treat me? Because I know that's the Christian way to do that. So that helps me to, you know, be the at least the best that I can be in healthcare, as I'm helping people who at the point that they're in, when they come my way, that they can't help themselves. And so just knowing that I have the faith and the strength that I have in God, that gives me the power every day to get up and go and do what I do. And I know that, you know, God will protect me, especially when I do my part. I have no doubt that God will always do the rest.
That's right. Absolutely. It's very key to have that relationship with God and have that assurance of what you know God will do. And Dr. Junior, I know in your own personal walk, the same thing, you know, applies with you. How does your faith in God keep you going and keep you strong as you're working the front lines?
Well, I take it that God is like oxygen. We don't necessarily see him, but it's there. And I also tell people that, you know, we can't see this coronavirus, but it's there and we just have to deal with it. But going back to God, he's the source of our strength. He's our creator. And if he is our creator, because the life we live and what we try to understand doesn't happen by chance. There is something there. And so every day that I wake up, I try to remember that this is my Father's world and just try to abide by that, because it's up to me to do my very best. It's almost like being on a team. You got five or six, basketball, you got five, football, you got 11, and you have to trust those people around you. It's so good that you don't have to trust people, but you can trust God, because they're going to do their job. God is going to do his job.
Amen. He always has, always will. That's a good thing about it. We got that assurance and we got that confidence in God. And, you know, that's why, you know, in James, when he's talking about what good is it to claim that we have such good faith in God and we know what God has done for us and we have that assurance. What good is it to know how good God is, but yet we see people who have needs and people who have various things that they're dealing with and going through, struggles that they're going through, and how is it that we could ignore persons who are dealing with their own struggles and not be able to allow the faith that we have in God for God to work through us to be able to bless them and to help them through what they're going through. So how do you tie that together as far as being able to help people through their struggles, through their needs? How do you feel that is important on a daily basis?
Well, when patients come to see me, one, I think they're saying in an underlying way that they have faith in me. They want to ask some questions or they're expecting some service. And so we just go from that idea that we're going to trust each other. And I've done my homework before we get together. And during that time, we try to figure out what's wrong. And then it's on that person to do, to execute the plan. So the thing is, it's just important. If they do come in and they see me and they ask me a question, for them to get, they're going to get an unbiased opinion. I mean, sometimes they don't like what I say, and sometimes I don't necessarily like what they say, but they've asked me to help solve their problem, so I try to do that.
Right. It's good you have that understanding. You know, it's a two-way communication here.
That's true.
Very important that you say that. Dr. Fry, what do you think about that?
Well, I agree with Dr. Junior on the part that, you know, first of all, I'm honored when people choose my services because they don't have to do that, you know. So I'm honored that they choose to come to me. And so when they do, I'm going to, you know, do my very best to give them the very best care that I can give them based upon my scope of practice, and realize that the reason why I am where I am is all because of God. And so I never forget that and make sure that that's part of everything that I do. And so, of course, that will always lead me in the right direction, because God will never fail you.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I call that, you know, that faith and service, that faith and mm-hmm. service in what you do and serving. You're really serving God as you're serving others.
Right.
You know, mm-hmm. It's a calling, if you will. Mm-hmm. You know, I have a call to preach the gospel, and I believe in our 9-to-5. You don't necessarily have to go to seminary. You don't have to, you know, be standing behind the pulpit preaching to congregations. Mm-hmm. Because guess what? There may be something come along where there's not going to be any people sitting out there for you to preach to.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. So your faith in God and what he's called you to, that calling is to mm-hmm. a call of a service. Mm-hmm. Wherever he tells you to go, whatever he tells you to do, mm-hmm. being able to do that and you're using the services that God has blessed you with to be able to bless those who are coming to you, who need that information, who need that encouragement. Mm-hmm. And also there's a level of sacrifice, you know, that goes along with putting that faith in action. Because sometimes, as Dr. Junior has said, sometimes people want to listen, sometimes they don't. Mm-hmm. Sometimes, you know, you go out of your way to do all you can do to try to help someone else, And sometimes in trying to help others, you wind up getting hurt yourself.
That's
a part of that sacrifice. And how important do you think sacrifice is to being able to put your faith in action?
Are you talking?
Yes, Dr. Okay.
Well, when you talk about sacrifice, that's something that, especially lately, that we're doing every day, you know, when we're on the front lines. And because any patient that we encounter, we don't know what the patient has, you know. Of course, they have other issues, but the fact that they can have a virus, like you said, that we can't see or know very little about, you know, that's a sacrifice within itself. But, you know, God wants us to sacrifice ourselves and to be the very best that we can for people. And so that's the reason why, you know, I believe that God puts certain people in certain positions, because that's what he, you know, expects that we would do. So we do sacrifice every day that we're on the front lines. But, you know, again, I rely on my faith, even in my sacrifice, in helping other people. And then, of course, just always doing the very best that I can, and doing what I know that I'm supposed to do to protect myself, too.
That's right. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. I just look at it that there's a sacrifice when the patient comes in of the time that they come. I mean, the time we're going to spend. Sometimes there's a little painful part of the sacrifice is that they got to get some blood drawn. And then they got to pay the bill. These things. But, you know, the thing is, it's good to sacrifice. But, you know, once you get the recommendation, just like I ask people, we need that blood work. I need for you to pick that medicine. Sometimes they choose not to. So the other side of the coin is obedience. If a person comes to see you and they just take all your advice, well, he just said that and then they leave, what do we accomplish? So your belief helps to guide you in a way that you get the desired outcome. We all have desired outcomes, and hopefully they can find their desired outcome. Sometimes it's not possible, but it begins, one, by making the sacrifice of time and following instruction.
That's right. And you know, you said something in there that I think is a key word, obedience. And you know, if we're going to have faith in God, it's going to require obedience obey God and obey his word. And, you know, God has said, you know, the way that we know that we really love God and trust him is if we do what he says, if we will walk in obedience to God. That builds our faith. And without faith, it is impossible to please God. But he that cometh to God must believe that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And as James chapter 2 said, it pointed out Abraham, who was the father of faith, and how Abraham, God had made him promises. And Abraham went on a journey. He said, God told him to go to the place that I'm going to show you. But really, how we know Abraham had faith and really trusted God is when God, who after all those years, Abraham and Sarah had been praying for a child and family, God blessed them with Isaac, the child of promise. And then God says to Abraham, now go and sacrifice Isaac on the altar. And you can imagine Abraham was like, really? I mean, you give me a child? To go and sacrifice, but Abraham did it. He responded. And we know how the story turns out. And sometimes in our lives, we have the privilege of being able to look at the word and kind of, you know, see full circle how the story ends. But in our test of faith, will we take the action on obedience of Abraham and to be able to make the sacrifice that God says, even the act, think about it, the action in his heart is what led God to say, now I know you trust me. Now I know you will not withhold anything from me. And that's the decisions that we have to make each and every day. Abraham's faith was proven by what he was willing to do in sacrificing his son Isaac. And didn't, you know, Abraham was ready to make a sacrifice, but God already had the sacrifice made for him. He already had the ram in the bush. And doesn't God do that for us? You know, in our daily lives, we think of we've got to do or things that are so tough and what are we doing? But think about how God comes in. And God always prepares a way. God always opens a door. God always does something that only God can do, but it requires faith. Mm-hmm. Be able to trust in God enough to know that you don't see how, you don't know how it's going to end, but you do know that God will provide. And so,
the question is, when you're standing at a crossroad, what do you do? Real sweet, when a fork is in the road. When the world is on your shoulders.
When the world is on your shoulders, what do you do?
When your back is up against the wall.
When your back is up against the wall.
Come on.
What do you do?
What do you do?
What do you do?
You hold on. Somebody sitting around you, keep the faith.
Keep the faith.
Come on, encourage somebody else. Keep the faith.
Keep the faith.
Come on, where do you look?
When there's nowhere else to look.
Where do you turn? When there's nowhere else to turn.
Where do you go?
When there's nowhere else to go.
What do you do?
When there's nothing else to do. You gotta remember, you're in the Master's hand. And the Master has a plan. So hold on.
How have you been able to see in some ways, I know we're going to get ready to wrap up, but how have you been able to see in some ways how God has come through and worked some things out for you personally and recently? Maybe you've got an example of that. Dr. Fry, you want to share with us?
Well, I think the people that have attended our Bible study, they know my story. With this office, I always, give God praise for, how he did bring me through this whole ordeal, because I, like I told you, when I made this decision to go ahead and take this office, I didn't pray ahead of time. And I know that I should always pray, before, just because I got a phone call saying there's an office that's available. Well, I needed to know what God wanted me to do, and so it was not the best decision when I first started, but God brought me through the whole thing. It looked like you couldn't see the forest for the trees, but I knew that God was always there. And then I began to pray and continue to pray. And so God has kept me sound and still here and still working and doing what I'm supposed to do. And now I'm almost at the end of all of this, and it's been a good journey.
Hallelujah. Amen. But God, all the way
through. Exactly, yes. We've never made it.
Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Dr. Junior?
Yeah, on May the 15th of this year, I went to the emergency room. I was having a little physical problem, so I went to the emergency room, and of course, because I had a, I was told I had a temperature. You know, they checked me, they put me in a COVID room. But they got my information, they drew my blood, and then a doctor came in and says, well, Dr. Junior, you have sepsis. And then he came back a little later, said, Dr. Junior, you have renal failure. And I was wondering what was going on. I got a CT scan, and within 2 or 3 hours after being told all this stuff, we figured out that I had a kidney stone. And where I started out, as far as where my white count was, where my renal function was, it was in a bad place. But over time, it all came back to normal. So I was given a set of instructions, and I've tried to be obedient to that or follow the recommendations as best I could. And because I did do it, I've had a pretty good 2 months since then. So hopefully there's much more out there for me.
Oh, yes. God is a miracle worker, and God Absolutely. Is a healer and a deliverer. And, you know, it's good. I'm glad you shared that, because some people need to know. Even the doctor had to go to the doctor.
Amen.
You can't self-diagnose and fix your own self, even though we try all the time.
Mm-hmm.
We see how God worked it out, and you're here as a living testimony to share the good news that God will make a way, and God still works on our behalf, and that's just good to know. And that's why I wanted to share this word, and I appreciate you for being with me about faith works, and that is something that is important in the life, as James put it, in the life of Abraham, even Rahab, who was a prostitute. God used her in a mighty way to be able to hide the spies and allow them to get back to carry the good report that they needed to give, that you know, the land was able for them to go in and conquer it. And God works, and God uses those who make themselves available.
Mm-hmm.
That's the key. We talked about faith in our service and in our sacrifice, but also faith in sincerity. Just saying, God, use me today for your purpose. Use me for your will. I want to allow my faith that I put into you to be put into action in what I say, in what I think, in what I do. And when you make yourself available, God will use you in a mighty way. The 22nd verse says this, and I'll leave you with it. You see that faith was active together with works, and by works, faith was made complete. And we know Jesus establishes something that really tied up in that faith, faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is love. And we know that if you love God and you know God loves you, then you're going to serve God. You're going to make sacrifices for God. You got a sincerity because you're not working just to be working. Right. But you know God has worked on your behalf, and God has been good to you and blessed you. So you are working out of that thankfulness and gratefulness, not working trying to prove how good you are, but because God has been good to you, and God has been working for you, and God now is working through you. There's great things that he wants to do in your life. And so we're thankful to have you share with us, Dr. Junior and Dr. Fry, this morning as we share on this first Sunday. Faith works. Yes, it does. It works when you believe. It works when you just humble yourself to just allow God to use you on a daily basis for his will and for his purpose and for his service. It's not easy. It's not going to be something where everything's going to be perfect. But guess what? Faith works even in the midst of it all. It's working for your good. You're going to come out in victory. So I want you to be encouraged. I thank God for each and every one of you this morning. Thank you again, Dr. Junior. Thank you again, Dr. Fry, for sharing with me. I want to close with a word of prayer this morning. for both of you and praying for those who are serving on the front lines. As we pray, Father God, we ask for your blessing, your strength, and your peace, God. Your peace that surpasses all understanding, that shall guard our hearts and our minds through Christ Jesus. We pray for that strength, Lord. Strength like no other, God. Strength that goes with us through the hard times and the hard places and the hard choices that we have to make. But God, we know we're never alone. We're not by ourselves, because faith works. God, you are working in us. You're working through us. And God, we're thankful that you are working for us, because you sent your son, Jesus Christ, sent him, Lord, to die for us on Calvary. But God, in his life that he lived, he allowed his faith to be working, God, in action and showing love to those around him. And that same faith and that same love you have given to us to put it in action on a daily basis. Bless us, God, that we might be a blessing to you. Thank you for the sacrifice that Jesus made for us on Calvary, God, that he gave his life, he hung, bled, and died for our sins, that we shall receive eternal life. Help us to believe. Help us to live by that faith, Lord, and walk by that faith and not by sight. And when we do, God, we surrender our lives to you anew and afresh, that you might use us each day for your will, your purpose, and your service, that in all we say and do, you will get the glory, honor, and the praise. Thank you, God, for these servants, Dr. Jr. Thank you, Lord, for Dr. Fry and their work, God. And we pray for them, their colleagues, the doctors, the medical professionals, the nurses, and all those who are working, God, on the front lines. Let them have hope, and let them, God, have faith in you, that, God, as they work, you would continue to work through them, God, and those who need encouragement, those who need direction, and, God, just those who just need an understanding, that, Lord, to just keep their hand in your unchanging hand. Thank you, God, that you're going to give them the words to speak, God, that you will continue to provide hope, salvation, God, and protection for all that we have and all that we need, Lord. Bless us and give us peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you. Thank you again for joining me this morning. And I'm so glad that faith works. And if we continue to work it, amen, God's going to continue to work through us. God bless you. Thank you again. Dr. Fry and Dr. Jr., we really appreciate you joining us this morning. God bless you.
Be blessed.
Well, thank you so much for joining us for worship today. We want to take this time to remember those families who have been dealing with bereavement. I want to remember the family of Sister Annie McGill Hardison, a great community servant and legend. Congressman John Lewis, C.T. Vivian, all who have passed this way. And those families locally who are serving during this time, their loved ones who are perhaps still in hospitals or wherever they might be, we're praying for you. And we know God will give you the strength to make it through. Listen, next Sunday, I want to invite each of you to join us at 12 noon. Our worship service on next Sunday will be at 12 noon as we join with our brothers and sisters from Hopewell AME Church as we celebrate, amen, the wonderful homecoming for Hopewell, celebrating 163 years of serving God. There is still hope in the well. We'll be joining them at 12 noon next Sunday for an hour of power. We'll have one service, 12 noon next Sunday. Our special guest preacher will be Reverend Tylan Orr, the pastor of Canaan AME Church. There in Mount Pleasant, and we're going to have a glorious time praising, thanking God, worshiping together as Bethel Chapel is going to worship an old-fashioned homecoming with Hopewell on next Sunday, 12 noon. Won't you join us and meet us in worship? God bless you. May God keep you. And now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace, both now and forever. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.
I want y'all to help us. Come on, rise to your feet. I've got evidence here.
I've got it.
I've got confidence.
I've got confidence.
I'm a conqueror.
I'm a conqueror.